Okay, low temp for sterilization. Okay, so other than steam and other high temperature sterilization, which I don't even bother with too much, okay, I didn't even talk about it. So if you reread the chapter on high temperature sterilization, it'll talk briefly about the just plain old high temperature sterilization. There's not much to go on, just, you know, briefly, gently read it. Steam is key, okay? But low temperature sterilization is about 20 to 25 other questions on the final exam as well, okay? So pay attention to this. There are three low temperature modalities that we have to be concerned with: ethylene oxide, hydrogen peroxide, and ozone. All right, we'll start off with ethylene oxide. Ethylene oxide is abbreviated as ETO. Hope I don't misspell it. Ethylene oxide. Now, what is ethylene oxide? Ethylene oxide is a deadly chemical. It kills everything. Okay? It starts off as a liquid, which has a very low boiling point. As a matter of fact, it turns into steam at roughly 52 degrees Fahrenheit. So, boils at approximately 52 degrees Fahrenheit and turns into gas. So oftentimes they talk about gassing something, they're talking about ethylene oxide. Okay? Now, like I said, ethylene oxide is a deadly chemical. It's a deadly gas that kills everything. Okay? 52 degrees Fahrenheit boiling point. Think of a nice spring day in the very beginning, right? The winter is just over. It's 52 degrees outside. The snow is melting. At that moment in time, ethylene oxide turns to gas. It boils. Okay? Make sense? Turns into gas. So let's talk about its pros and cons a little bit. So first things first, I said that it's a deadly gas that kills everything! Exclamation point. Let's talk about pros and cons. Pros and cons. Let's start with pros. First things first, I want to tell you that ethylene oxide is a small molecule. What does that mean and why do we care? Well, we care because they will ask you a question on the test and, you know, they will ask you, what is ethylene oxide? Well, it's deadly gas. It's a small molecule. Now, why is it important for us to know that it's a small molecule? All right? Well, what's the difference between driving a large pickup truck and one of those stupid smart cars that you see on the street?
More room.
Huh?
More room.
More room for what?
Things to go inside.
You mean for a truck? Mm-hmm. It's true. But what would you see the advantage of driving a... When would you find it advantageous to drive this stupid smart car? Oh, that's right. You can fit into everything. Okay, now we're getting somewhere. So, it's a small molecule that's able to get into everything. Fantastic. So why is that good? Because it's a small molecule, it has excellent penetration. And you know what? One of the pros is that it also kills everything. You know what? I'm gonna put kills everything, right here. We'll list it first. Excellent penetration. You know what else is good? We already have an answer on the board. It does it at low temperature. Kills at low temperature. Why is that important? Well, because high temperatures sometimes warp delicate instruments. Make sense? Now, because it has excellent penetration and it is a small molecule, it is good on instruments with lumens. Okay, remember, instrument with lumen is like a suction catheter, right, which has a long hollow piece inside, like a tube, right? And you got stuff inside, ethylene oxide will get in there and will kill it, okay? So we got pros so far, kills everything, excellent penetration, kills at low temperature, it's good on instruments with lumens. Oh, you know what else it's really good at? It's compatible with most packaging material. Make sense? Compatible with most packaging materials. All right, we get into everything. We kill everything. We do it at low temperature. We're compatible with most packaging materials. Did I miss anything? I don't think so. These are the pros. Let's talk about the cons. You know what? If something kills everything, it's also able to kill everyone. Exclamation point. And you know what? If you think of a toxic gas and how it may kill people, well, you know what? They call this a carcinogen. It may cause cancer. Actually, it does. It's a carcinogen. That's a biggie. So I am here to tell you that this particular medium for sterilization, though it's used in some places, is by far not used everywhere because of this specific reason. Only specialty departments and specialty hospitals have this. Not everyone has it. All right? A place like Mass Eye and Ear, for example, has it because it's sensitive, delicate eye instruments that may be corroded by steam, which are better off with ethylene oxide as a sterilant. Make sense? Okay, now, some of the other cons, and we'll come back to this, you know what, before I get into other things, if it's able to kill people, then people and spaces where this thing is being utilized has to be very carefully monitored. Okay? Requires space and personnel monitoring. And we'll get into things like TWA, PPM, STEL. We'll talk about this a little bit later. So if it talks about the space and personnel monitoring, we're also talking about things like OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health Administration, being heavily involved in its monitoring, and we have to be responsible for their oversight. Okay, make sense? Next one, which is a biggie, really biggie, leaves a toxic residue. Now, we should be able to understand the word residue. Leftovers. Toxic residue. In other words, let me ask you a question. If you were to wash your plates, your dinnerware, with Clorox bleach, would they be clean?
Yeah.
Sure. My follow-up question to that is, would you eat off of them? No. Why not?
Just
bleach is left over. Under what circumstances would you eat off of these plates again? If you wash them with regular water to make sure to get rid of the residue. Correct? Well, guess what? Guess what? We have to do the same thing here. Okay? But we don't wash them after sterilization. Okay? To remove the residue. We will perform a procedure called aeration. Requires extensive aeration. So let me tell you something. The process of ethylene oxide sterilization is two-part. Part one, sterilization or exposure. Part two, aeration. It's the same as doing your laundry at home. Wash cycle, dry cycle. Now, which cycle is longer? Wash or dry?
Dry.
Of course, if you do your laundry, you all know that the dry cycle is longer. What does the dry cycle involve for regular laundry? How does the dryer work? Blows hot air through your clothes. So what does hot air do? It turns the water, leftover water on your clothing, into steam and then blows it out. That's why the exhaust is always wet, unless the clothes are already dry. Then it's dry. Right?
Yes.
Well, guess what? This is exactly, to a T, the process of aeration. Now, process of aeration can be as long as, if I remember correctly, 12 hours. Could be 14. We'll double check later. But between 8 and 12 hours just to aerate. And the process of sterilization, it depends on how, is 6 to 8 hours. So let me ask you a question. How long does it take for us to turn around a load? A whole day. There's no such thing as an unexpected case that needs to be handled quickly with ethylene oxide sterilization. It is long. Takes a long time. You can do almost a day. And in this particular case, you can reduce a little bit your cycle of aeration by a little while by changing the temperature. If you increase the temperature just a little bit, it drops the aeration time significantly. Okay? The sooner you turn it into a gas, the sooner it'll be ready for you. So one of the drawbacks, takes a really long time, requires extensive aeration, leaves a toxic residue. And by the way, if it leaves a toxic residue on the instrument, who does that impact? If you didn't aerate things properly,
the patient.
And if we affect the patient negatively, what federal agency, may I ask, may be interested in that? If we touch a patient with anything, OSHA is about employees.
FDA.
Huh? The FDA. The Food and Drug Administration, that's correct. Okay? So the FDA is also involved. You got OSHA, you got FDA involved. All right, let me stick that over here so you understand. Up on top. OSHA is involved. FDA is involved. And guess what? You know, we're not done yet with the federal agencies, or state, because they have their affiliates here too. These two guys, you know, they cost money. But you know, they have to deliver the the ethylene oxide to you as well. So that means they use public roadways to transport these cylinders. Now, next time you're driving in a car and you see certain trucks making deliveries, you know, with cylinders of gas on them, take a look how many different permits and how many different signs they have on them trucks. Not only that, but they're permitted to drive on the road only in specific hours of the day. You are not going to see them on the road in rush hour. At night. That's right. Oh my God. And the Homeland Security right now is involved too. you try to, you know, deliver some oxygen tanks. You would think oxygen, it's the air we breathe. Not so fast. You mix it with a little gasoline, a little match, next thing you know, high explosives. Everyone has interchangeable parts. So you're not going to see these trucks driving. So you have Department of Transportation is involved. DOT. And guess what? When we aerate in your house, when you have your laundry, the dryer working, where does the exhaust fan go?
Outside.
Well, there's nothing wrong with a little harmless steam now, is it? But when we're venting out the ethylene oxide, where does that go?
Into a container.
Oh, heck no. It goes straight into the air.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
They don't send it through scrubbers?
No! Scrubbers. No. Well, the EPA does allow a certain amount of latitude. Oh, what's wrong? A couple of pigeons will drop dead outside.
Oh, my God.
Who cares about the little pigeon? 1, 2, 3, he's dead. No, but seriously. So the EPA is also involved. Hey, listen, we have this whole alphabet soup over here. Believe me when I tell you, the more letters you add to the regulatory agencies, the more money it costs, no? You like my French. I do too. The EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency. Boy, do they cost a lot of money. In any event, these are the pros and cons of ethylene oxide. And I gotta tell you, there's only one other thing that I have to put up over here. And remember I told you that steam, for example, kills by temperature and pressure? Well, ethylene oxide has none of these things. It has no temperature, no pressure, right? So it kills by a specific process. And this process is called alkylation. So, kills by alkylation. Means it alkalizes something, and it is dead. Toot sweet. Well, not so toot sweet because it takes almost a day, but you know what? It will die. Make sense? Not rocket science now, is it? Oh. One more. We use, remember when I asked you a question about what is the name of the biological indicator for steam, and you said it was Geobacillus stereothermophilus? I can say it better than you can. For now. Practice. You have no idea how smart it makes you look when you say Geobacillus stereothermophilus at work. Oh. Think rays. But for ethylene oxide, we use a little different, the biological indicator. So biological indicator for ethylene oxide is something called Bacillus atrophius. Geobacillus stereothermophilus. But this is Bacillus atrophius.
Geobacillus.
Geobacillus stereothermophilus for everything else, and Bacillus atrophius, God, I hope I spelled it correctly. Mm-hmm. We'll check with the book a little bit later. Close enough. So, Bacillus atrophius is the biological indicator for ethylene oxide. Comprimo? Si, oui, oui.
Oui, oui.
Oh, very nice. Si. So, let me know if I can... Oh, I'm running out of eraser juice. Uh-oh. May I?
Yes.
Oui, oui. Excellent.
There's more over there.
Where? Oh, yeah. Nice. Oh, you have no idea what I went through this Sunday. I'm still trying to regain my consciousness and my senses. After what happened. Oh, would you like to know while I erase the board? Once a year, I do this charitable thing. It's my good deed for the entire year. I don't do any more good deeds. But I teach CPR to the incoming camp counselors, to several camps in Boston. And Sunday, I taught CPR from 10 a.m. In the morning till about 8:30 at night. And I had about 100 teenage girls in my class. So, because I taught multiple classes. I gotta tell you, you have to give them, teachers in high schools, a standing ovation every time you see them, no matter how bad they are. If they haven't killed these people in their classrooms, they deserve praise. Steve, bad news. It's almost empty. In any event, so that's what I did. Now, imagine me at this stage of my development, in my transition from normal middle-aged adulthood to just being an old guy. I was on my knees most of the day, dealing with them girls and teaching them CPR. I was exhausted. By the time I came home, I was basically useless for everything. And yesterday, I still hadn't recovered, and I'm still in pain. I think this is the last year. No more good deeds. It's time for them to find another sucker to do this.
Where did you?
Huh?
Where did you get?
Well, there's a few kids camps around the area where I live that do this, and they started their sessions yesterday on Monday, and on Sunday everybody had to make sure to have their CPR certification. Oh, I should have worn knee pads. I should have had somebody else do it.
Because they sent us from here for a CPR certification.
Oh yeah, yeah. No. I don't do that for class.
Oh.
It's fine. No. I don't teach CPR. This is just a. It's not worth any money. That's why I do it for free. That way I can say, hey, I did it for nothing. Lay off. About 100 of them. 100. Horrible. Okay. Are we ready? Next batch would be H2O2, also known as gas plasma. H2O2. What does that look like?
H2O.
Yeah. So if I just take away one more oxygen, I have
water.
What the?
Water. Oxygen.
Yeah. But I add one oxygen, and I have H2O2, which is hydrogen peroxide, which is also known as gas plasma. Imagine that. We take two gases, arrange them, two hydrogens, one oxygen, and instead of gas, we now have this universal liquid, which without which we can't survive. But you add one more oxygen to that and you got hydrogen peroxide. Everyone has a bottle of hydrogen peroxide in their medicine cabinet for the most part. It costs a dollar at the dollar store, right? Brown bottle. You keep it when you need it. Get a cut, get a bruise, pour it on there and it kills whatever is on there and you avoid infection. But that's just one oxygen. It's like I banned soft drinks in my house. Like Coca-Cola and stuff like that, because it's just nasty. Shouldn't drink that stuff.
Yeah.
And any carbonated beverages, they all stink equally bad. Don't consume them under any circumstances. Hideous. Especially the stuff they sell now. Look, 1 out of 10 Americans is sick with diabetes. Gee, I wonder why. They don't even have real sugar in there anymore. It's like right now, 4th of July is coming. If you go to Home Depot, you will find that they're selling Coca-Cola over there in buckets. Buckets of Coca-Cola in glass bottles inside of a tin bucket. You're supposed to pour ice in there and enjoy yourself, right? And there'll be a big sign that says, with real sugar. Wow! Other than that, they sell it with high fructose corn syrup. Pure poison. People, don't drink that stuff. Carbon dioxide is bad for you, high fructose syrup is bad for you, and to be honest with you, that sugar they put in there, the amount of it, it's pretty bad.
I was hoping.
Yeah. In any event, it's all right. Don't worry. You can keep it on there. But I really don't recommend drinking it. So I banned the soft drinks in my house. And, you know, I have one of my my son's Goonie friends show up. Why can't we drink this Coca-Cola in your house? I was like, because it's nasty. I said, how is it nasty? I said, well, it's got carbon dioxide in there. Don't you understand that it's a waste product? Every time you try to exhale, you exhale carbon dioxide. Why the hell would you pump it into your body? Oh, I see. It's kind of stupid, it says. Why can't they put, you know, oxygen bubbles in there? That'll be healthy. And I said, son, see, that's why you flunk chemistry. If they put oxygen in there, you'll be drinking hydrogen peroxide. That's even worse. So, see? See how it all works out? In any case, oh yeah, I guess you're right. I guess I am. Now go pay attention.
But even the ginger ale?
They all stink. They're bad. Bad. Bad, 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 bad. Don't even the seltzer without any additives. I mean, carbon dioxide. All these bubbles, it's a waste product. Why do you want to put that into your... You know, just drink plain old clean water.
Filter?
Yeah, even juice you have to look for. They spike it with all sorts of stuff. This Snapple thing that I bought, it has no high fructose corn syrup. So that's why, you know, I put it in there. But you look at anything, it says second ingredient, high fructose corn syrup. People, it's bad stuff. Don't consume it. So let's talk about H2O2 and gas plasma, okay? Hydrogen peroxide. It's a low temperature sterilant. Well, it kills pretty much everything too.
We're doing pros and cons?
We're gonna do pros and cons. Pros? Cons. Well, we know that hydrogen peroxide is in your medicine cabinet. You can do just about everything with it. Disinfect wounds, right?
Some people use it to brush their teeth.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Feel free. It's one of the best things you can stick in your mouth. Just don't drink it. But absolutely, there's almost nothing better than hydrogen peroxide as mouthwash. It's great. Hey, it kills everything. All right? So, but you also know that it's kind of benign. You can put it on your skin. So, is it toxic?
No.
So let's put that on top. No. Non-toxic. And if it's non-toxic, unlike ethylene oxide, it does not leave a toxic residue. No toxic residue. It's also at low temperature. But I have to teach you a little bit of something about low temperature. It's not like ethylene oxide low temperature that you get something up to about 53 degrees and it boils. Hydrogen peroxide doesn't do that. If you want to see what hydrogen peroxide does, you know, you try to boil it at home. Take a bottle, try to boil it. Ruin a dollar, right? See at what temperature it's going to boil. It's pretty close to water. So how is it that we can use it as a low temperature sterilant? I will show you. Cons. You know what? Not so great with lumens. And not compatible with most packaging materials. In reality, the packaging material that it likes is something called Tyvek. You've seen houses being built, they wrap them up in this white material, it says Tyvek, Tyvek, Tyvek. Well, Tyvek is a brand name of the DuPont Corporation, God bless them. They do a lot of good stuff. A little bad stuff. But Tyvek is the packaging material of choice for hydrogen peroxide or gas plasma. Its biological indicator is our favorite Geobacillus stereothermophilus, so we don't have to worry about it. But we have to know how it kills. If ethylene oxide killed by alkylation, H2O2, hydrogen peroxide, also known as gas plasma, kills by oxidation. Kills everything by oxidation. Very important to know. Now, at high concentrations, hydrogen peroxide is toxic, and it will burn you. Because the hydrogen peroxide that we have in our bathroom cabinet is at relative low concentrations. The hydrogen peroxide that we have in the hospital inside the sterilizers is at high concentration. So, can it harm you? Yes, it can. It can burn your skin, not permanently, but I had a couple of drops fall on my hands. You know, they looked like, they were covered by ash, looked like a burn. They were so white.
How can I put that in my mouth?
It's at low concentration. The one that you have at home is at low concentration. It's not going to do anything. I don't say that's why the one in the hospital that goes inside the machine, we don't even handle it with our hands. We don't take a bucket of hydrogen peroxide.
When you touch acetone.
Something like that. It looks that way too. Yeah. Makes sense, right? So that's what it'll do. Now, that's all you need to know really about this. I just have to teach you now about how it actually works. Okay? So, can I erase this?
Yeah.
All right.
Does that take a long time?
No, not so bad. It only takes a couple of hours. And the other good thing about it is because it's done at low temperatures, there's no cooling time required. Like when we do things with high temperatures, we have to cool it down. Now, when I talk a little bit more further, remember I put a few things on the board and said we have to talk later about ethylene oxide. Okay, there's a few things about procedure for ethylene oxide that I have to discuss with you. So remind me to get back to procedure for ethylene oxide. All right?
I have a question.
Yeah.
On these low temp sterilants.
Yep.
The chemical indicator doesn't work then, right?
It does.
It does because I thought that was done by heat.
No. It's exposure to sterilant. Okay, certain things on that chemical indicator tape, for example, it reacts to steam having both heat and moisture, okay, and it changes color. But if I show you here, 1 second, check this out, right? Watch this. This is a peel package, right? And if I show you this peel package here, it says two chemical indicators. Steam or EO gas. They marked it as EO. It's ETO or EO. It's one and the same. So ethylene oxide on this side, steam on this side. So whatever it exposes to, don't just think it's heat. It's the actual chemical. You know, one thing you need to understand about chemical indicators, right? You know what you can compare it to easily? You can compare it to a pregnancy test. That's a chemical indicator. Radiator fluid tester in the car to see how good the concentration of the radiator coolant fluid is. It changes color, okay? Same thing with a pregnancy test. If it reacts to a chemical found in urine for a female that shows a certain hormone being present inside the urine, then it'll react to it and change color. Make sense? Okay. So, let's move on. How does gas plasma sterilizers work? Very important aspect you have to remember. H2O or gas plasma sterilizers rely on a deep vacuum draw. Now, once you write that down, it's very important for you to have. So H2O2 relies on the deep vacuum draw. Now, remember, well, I don't know if you remember, so I'm going to remind you. When we talked about dynamic air removal sterilizers, I talked about sucking out all the air from the chamber and creating as much of a vacuum in there as possible. And I told you why we did that. Because low pressure or vacuum reduces the boiling temperature of water. I mean, if I have a really solid vacuum, the water will boil also at about 50 degrees Fahrenheit. So if I have a vacuum, the water will begin to evaporate all by itself only because of decreased pressure. But if I apply a little heat, 50, 60 degrees at the very most, the water boils. Amazing. So H2O2, which has similar characteristics to water, relies on the deep vacuum draw. So first things first, let's say we load up our sterilizer with packages wrapped up in Tyvek wrap with lots of space between the packages so they don't touch one another, blah, 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 right? We push them into the sterilizer, we close the door, and we begin our preconditioning phase, during which time the sterilizer will develop a deep vacuum draw. Deep vacuum inside the chamber. After that, I will inject my hydrogen peroxide. So, step one, deep vacuum draw. Step two, inject H2O2. At that moment in time, it turns into a vapor. In a deep vacuum and a, you know, warm temperature, not hot, but warm, it's still low temperature, right? Inject H2O2, it turns into H2O2 vapor. Now comes the important step. I'll put a little star next to it, a little bigger circle for you to understand. Once the packages absorb H2O2, it permeates all the packages. After that, we zap it with a radio frequency. It's a very technical term. Zap the vapor with a, they call it RF for short, or radio frequency. And that turns it into what they call plasma. That's why this method is also known as gas plasma sterilization. So this radio frequency, once we zap it, turns the H2O2 molecule into plasma, into gas plasma, making it very angry. Imagine it's an H2O2 molecule. Now we zap it with a radio frequency. Now it's bristling with power. Like, what's that superhero that's popular nowadays? Who's that guy with that thing in the middle of his chest? The Iron Man. Right? So it's like the Iron Man of molecules over there. So first it turns, we do a draw, create a deep vacuum. At that moment in time, because the pressure is so low, anything will boil at a lower temperature. We inject H2O2 into the chamber. It turns into steam right away, into a vapor. Permeates all of the packages. And when it's permeated with that fog of hydrogen peroxide, that kills. Hydrogen peroxide kills. And on top of that, we zap it with a radio frequency, making it really pissed off and angry. So anything it touches, it will kill. Zap, haha, dead meat. Right? And that's how it works. After that, step number five, another deep vacuum to get rid of the sterilant. So now we suck out the gas plasma and exhaust. Deep vacuum and exhaust. And that finishes our cycle with H2O2.
How long does it take?
roughly 2 hours. All together. Some advantages, some disadvantages. We already went over that. Very exciting. Clear?
As water.
Thank you. Not all water is clear. You know, one thing you should know, it's especially important for H2O2. H2O2, gas plasma, does not like the following things. Does not like paper, cotton, or linen. One end in linen, isn't it? Or two ends?
One.
Okay. The question is,
why?
Because paper, cotton, and linen contain cellulose. So who cares? Cellulose. God, you know, I'm having a cellulose, 1L, 2L, whatever,
that's
close
right.
enough.
That's right.
Yeah, very nice, thank you. So cellulose absorbs H2O2. I'm still getting over that CPR class. I can't, you know what, I think I need a week's vacation from this. I'm literally in pain, I'm telling you. So cellulose absorbs H2O2. If it absorbs H2O2, how good is it for us? It prevents contact, right? That's why we use Tyvek. Tyvek doesn't absorb anything, but has these properties that lets the sterilant in, lets the sterilant out, and then protects the instruments. It's really good. Does this make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Believe me when I tell you, this is going to be on the National Board examination, I assure you. Okay, so, low temp, kills by oxidation, does not leave a toxic residue, doesn't take so long, but conversely, doesn't like all the packaging materials, as long as, you know, all of our favorite ones, paper, cotton, linen, we don't like, we only like Tyvek, all right? And, well, that's it for now. All these things that we talked about, this is important, okay? Make sense? Last but not least, and very little information, would be ozone or O3. Okay? So, all set?
Yep.
What does the top say? H2O?
Two.
Yeah, the whole thing though.
Gas plasma. Come on, you have to give me a little more. I gotta figure this thing out. Last but not least, O3, also known as ozone. What the heck is O3? Well, yeah, I just said it's ozone, but it's very close to O2, is it not?
Yeah.
So if O2 is O and O, that would be oxygen. Put one more O, and you got O3. So it's still an oxygen. It's just a different type of oxygen molecule that we call ozone. Do you know where you find ozone most frequently? Or when? Yeah. They said the ozone layer. We're destroying the ozone layer. Oh my God, we're all going to die. My rear end. How is ozone made? Does anybody know? Lightning strikes. Every time there's a thunderstorm, we make ozone. You know what happened? And you know that there are places in the world where there's lightning all the time. It doesn't end. We don't have to wait for a thunderstorm. In some places over the ocean or in the mountains, lightning takes place all the time, constantly and continually manufacturing ozone. A little bit of ozone is good for you. A lot of ozone will kill you. And you know how it will kill you? By oxidation. Kills by oxidation. I'm here to tell you that you will more than likely not see ozone sterilizers in any of the hospitals that you go to nowadays. It's a process by which they're still trying to develop. The technology is not quite there yet, but it works very similarly to the sterilizer that we just discussed, which is H2O2. Okay? Does that make sense? So H2O2 gas plasma and ozone are very similar. As a matter of fact, dirty little secret is, the gas plasma sterilizer actually makes ozone in itself during one of its cycles, O3. Yeah. Okay, it's one of the byproducts. So ozone, if O3 is made out in the atmosphere, do we need to buy ingredients for it? So this particular sterilant I could just make out of thin air?
Yeah.
Yeah. You don't need to buy anything. You just take regular air, separate it into its components, nitrogen, oxygen, whatever else we got in there, carbon dioxide. Separate that, take pure oxygen, zap it with a radio frequency or electric impulse, and you have O3. So what happens is, O3 is a very unstable form of oxygen, okay? And how do we make it? It's like if you go on a date, right? Usually it's two people that go on a date. Let's not get into political aspects of it. Usually it's two people of the opposite sex, all right? And then sometimes you have a best friend with nothing to do and you sort of let them tag along.
Third wheel.
The third wheel.
See, you can still go have dinner, but it just at some point in time it becomes just uncomfortable. The situation is totally unstable, unacceptable. Right?
Yeah.
Well, that's ozone. It'll hang around together as an O3, but it really wants to degenerate back into O2 because O2 is really stable, right? But when it's O3, it will kill. Kill by oxidation. Guess what? It also relies on a deep vacuum draw. It also uses Tyvek. And it also uses radio frequency. Does not need sterilant. Is it toxic? No. No toxic residue. Technology not there yet to use this every day as a stable means of sterilization. Therefore, you are not going to see it as a commonplace sterilizer. I haven't seen it in any of the hospitals in the area, and we have some of the biggest ones, as you know. All right, so not much else to talk about. Relies on the old Geobacillus stereothermophilus.
Can you explain do not need sterilant?
Yeah, we make it out of thin air. I don't need to buy anything.
Oh.
Because remember, it's oxygen. All I got to do is separate out oxygen from the other gases in the atmosphere, take the oxygen, zap it with a radio frequency, right? Clump together that, you know, third thing, you know, third oxygen, that extra person on the date, and you have your O3. That's it. But only for a short while we're playing games and sterilizing. After that, it falls apart. Make sense? That's it. Now, I asked you to remind me to get back to ethylene oxide a little bit, did I not?
Yeah.
I'm just reminding myself. Can I erase this?
Yes.
One second.
Believe me when I tell you, there are no other questions that you will have on the national exam. I won't waste my time. I won't waste your time. Having said that, let me find the right page in the book, and I will tell you what you do need to go over on top of everything else.
341?
You are probably right. Yes, indeed, you are correct. Page 341. If you're going to review anything on low temperature sterilization, please make it page 341. That's where we have the table on which it tells us everything and anything you need to know about all these things. So everything we talked about is on page 341. Now, a little bit more about ethylene oxide. That I neglected to mention.
What did that last line say?
Which one?
The last line.
No residue.
But it says in the ozone.
Yeah.
In the packaging.
Yeah.
It says compatible with most products.
It likes Tyvek. And on the test, that's what they're going to say.
Tyvek.
Tyvek. Right, Tyvek. So more on ethylene oxide, just a little bit more. Now, I understand we're kind of buzzing right through this. We're going light speed on this, all right? Take it. You know, folks, I know that some of you watch my YouTube channel religiously, that you can see a lot of this information on there. Watch it. Watch it. Review these things. Everything I say is going to be on there, okay? You can do it. So a little more in ethylene oxide. I mentioned to you that there is something that they do called personnel monitoring, right? First things first. Most important for people to wear a personnel monitoring badge. I'm sure you've had x-rays taken in the hospital and you've seen technicians that work in that department wear little badges. And they go, oh, what's this? It's a radiation badge. Whew. Okay, well, we have similar badges when we are working in the area where there's ethylene oxide. The thing that you need to know about this is that it needs to be worn in the breathing zone. Must be worn in the breathing zone. Where is the breathing zone, you may ask? I will tell you. 12 inches around the nose and mouth. Don't put on your belt. Put it on your collar. Want to keep it on your hat? You can. Breathing zone. 12 inches around the nose and mouth.
Why?
Because that's where you inhale. And as you inhale, if there's toxic gas around, okay?
What does the badge do?
Oh, what does the badge do? It doesn't do anything to help you. What it does, what it does is that it monitors what you have been exposed to. And once a month, or whatever the policy may be, you will mail that in, and you will see if you have been exposed to anything. And then you know whether you're dying or not.
No.
Not quite so extreme. There are different types of badges designed for different types. Okay, so after that, I told you that we're going to deal with some things called STEL, right? TWA and PPM. First things first, what does STEL stand for? It stands for short-term exposure limit. Short-term exposure limit. Further, TWA is not a defunct airline. TWA is something called time weighted average. What does that mean? That's when they take your total exposure to something, they divide it by or into 8 hours, and they show you how much you were exposed to over a period of 8 hours. That doesn't mean that continuously throughout the 8 hours you've been exposed. You may have been exposed once, inhaling some kind of a toxic fume. But they simply divide that into 8 hours because that's the average shift. PPM stands for parts per million. Parts per million is a unit of measure, like a pound. How many pounds per dollar can you buy? Oh shit, I don't even know what you can buy. How many pounds per dollar? It used to be for a dollar you can buy like a couple of pounds of bananas. Sometimes you still can. But it's parts per million. It's parts of some kind of a toxic substance diluted in million parts of, in this particular case, air. So we have million molecules of air mixed in with certain amount of pollutants in those million molecules. So that's a unit of measure. PPM, STEL, TWA are measured in PPM. On page 341, on that table, it tells you how many parts per million you can be exposed to as a time-weighted average for all three sterolins. If my memory serves me correctly, ETO was 1.0 ppm.
Mm-hmm.
No, not all. Ozone, I believe, is 0.1.
Yep.
So is H2O2, if I remember correctly.
It's
1.0. 1.0? Okay. You need to remember that for the exam. Okay? So you need to know the time-weighted average in ppm for the exam. Oh, it rhymed. Did you hear that? Man, I'm a poet. Okay, does this make sense?
Yeah.
Now, I promise to talk just a little bit more about... places where we handle ethylene oxide, we also have not just personnel monitoring, we have facility monitoring. So we have things just like we have, for example, a smoke detector, we have ethylene oxide detector. So if there's a leak, it goes... Get out. Stop breathing. Drop dead. So, you know, with that in mind, you have to know that ethylene oxide, wherever it is that you're using it, has to be in a well-ventilated place. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, let me tell you a little...
Can you get gas masks on?
Oh, no. Listen, I got to tell you, this equipment is pretty safe. You know, if you want to consider the possibilities of having some kind of a gas leak, it ain't going to happen. Just not. Okay? Now, I have to tell you a little bit about ethylene oxide cycle and how we handle things. Okay? It used to be. It doesn't happen anymore. Ethylene oxide used to be just like your washer and dryer, two separate machines. Today, they only manufacture ethylene oxide one unit that does the sterilization and aeration all at once. But for the purpose of the exam, you need to understand that there are two machines that they're talking about. Sterilizer, aerator. Now, with that in mind, you need to transfer from the sterilizer to the aerator. Before you take anything out from your sterilizer to the aerator, you need to open the door. Okay? 6 inches for 15 minutes. So, before taking out the load, or before you take out the load, open the door 6 inches for 15 minutes. Let it breathe out.
So how do you know how wide the door is?
Well, listen, you should know approximately what 6 inches looks like. If it's 5 inches, it's fine. If it's 7 inches, it's also okay. If it's 8 inches, all right. But the test says 6 inches. How you know? I don't know. Use your best judgment. Does this make sense? 15 minutes. Let it air out a little bit. You know, let the fumes come out. There are some. Then, take your load and transfer the load onto a stainless steel cart with a solid bottom and closed doors. I'm too lazy to write that down. Okay. Transfer load onto stainless steel cart with doors and solid bottom. Yeah. See what I do for you? I had to even write that down. But we're not done yet. For $19.99, you can have two. No. And here is the kicker. By the way, I'm here to tell you, no matter how trivial this may sound, it's on the test. Ridiculous, but nonetheless. Pull the cart. Do not push. Why? Because as you push something, it aerates the stuff into you. So as you're pushing something, the air cycles through your load. And if there's any residual ETO, it's going to be in your nose. I mean, I can share a really old story with you. I remember when I was in the military, my first night, they gave me a helmet, a rifle, backpack, and it was really dark at night. But those military helmets, they have these two cat eyes in the back, and they're phosphorus, and they burn for just a little while, so you can see the guy in front of you. But they only, like, stayed lit for 20 minutes. So, you know, when it became really dark, they went out, you couldn't see in front of you. So I got my rifle, I got my helmet on, and once that helmet comes on, you feel instantly stupid, at least for the first time you do it. So the helmet is on, I feel like I'm in some kind of a cone, it's the woods, it's dark, I'm lost. I mean, I don't know what I'm doing or where I'm going. So I'm there traipsing through the woods. The only thing that saved me from being completely and totally lost was one thing and one thing only. They served us Franks and beans that night. The guy in front of me was passing gas so much that I could only follow him by scent.
Oh my God.
So I, like a dog, the only thing that was working, my brain was not functioning. I didn't know what the heck was going on. I smelled my way to safety. Well, that's my story. If you walk behind the cart, you will sniff out the ethylene oxide. Don't. And then you load the aerator. Please wear gloves. All right? And that's it. There is nothing else to say about low temperature sterilization. It's a big section. 20 to 25 questions on the test. So between high temperature sterilization and low temperature sterilization, you got 50 questions. One third. You add packaging materials, one half. Talk about cleaning and decontamination, 100 questions. Everything else is commentary. So between four chapters that we already discussed so far, you covered most of the test. Am I clear?
Yep.
I mean, this is, you know, I don't want to say that it's primitive, but in reality, if you simply go over what we talked about in class, you're safe. Safe. I feel comfortable turning off the recording.